Through the entrance rushes in a swarm of fleeing rats that try to storm the walls. Torches light up the confusion. Everyone yells and curses and slaughters. The madness and despair of many hours unloads itself in this outburst. Faces are distorted, arms strike out, and the beasts scream. We must stop in time, just in time to avoid attacking one another. The onslaught has exhausted us. We lie down to wait again. It is a marvel that our post has no casualties so far. It is one of the less deep dugouts. A corporal creeps in. He has a loaf of bread with him. Three people have had the luck to get through during the night and bring some provisions. They say the bombardment extends undiminished as far as the artillery lines. It is a mystery where the enemy gets all its shells. We wait and wait. By midday, what I expected happens. One of the recruit has a fit. I've been watching him for a long time, grinding his teeth and opening and shutting his fists. These hunted, protruding eyes, we know them too well. During the last few hours, he has had merely the appearance of calm. He had collapsed like a rotten tree. Now he stands up, stealthily creeps across the floor, hesitates a moment, and then glides towards the door. I intercept him and say, "Where are you going?" "I'll be back in a minute," says he, and tries to push past me. "Wait a bit, the shelling will stop soon." He listens for a moment, and his eyes become clear. Then again, he has the glowering eyes of a mad dog. He's silent. He shoves me aside. "One minute, lad," I say. Cat notices. Just as the recruit shakes me off, Cat jumps in and we hold him. Then he begins to rave. "Leave me alone. Let me go. I will go out." He won't listen to anything and hits out. His mouth is wet and pours out words, half-choked, meaningless words. It is a case of claustrophobia. He feels as though he is suffocating here and wants to get out at any price. If we let him go, he would run about everywhere regardless of cover. He is not the first. Though he raves and his eyes roll, it can't be helped. We have to give him a hiding to bring him to his senses. We do it quickly and mercilessly, and at last he sits down quietly. The others have turned pale. Let's hope it deters them. The bombardment is too much for the poor devils. They have been sent straight from a recruiting depot into a barrage that is enough to turn an old soldier's hair gray. After this affair, the sticky, close atmosphere works more than ever on our nerves. We sit as if in our graves, waiting only to be closed in. Suddenly it howls and flashes terrifically. The dugout cracks in all its joints under a direct hit. Fortunately, only a light one that the concrete blocks are able to withstand. It rings metallically. The walls reel. Rifles, helmets, earth, mud, and dust fly everywhere. Sulfur fumes pour in. If we were in one of those light dugouts that they have been building lately instead of this deeper one, none of us would be alive. But the effect is bad enough even so. The recruit starts to rave again and two others follow suit. One jumps up and rushes out. We have trouble with the other two. I start after the one who escapes and wonder whether to shoot him in the leg. Then it shrieks again. I fling myself down and when I stand up, the wall of the trench is plastered with smoking splinters, lumps of flesh, and bits of uniform. I scramble back. The first recruit seems to have actually gone insane. He butts his head against the wall like a goat. We must try tonight to take him to the rear. Meanwhile, we bind him, but in such a way that in case of an attack, he can be released at once. Cat suggests a game of scat. It's easier when a man has something to do, but it is no use. Listen for every explosion that comes close, miscount the tricks, and fail to follow suit. We have to give it up. We sit as though in a boiler that is being belabored from without on all sides. Night again. We are deadened by the strain, a deadly tension that scrapes along one's spine like a gapped knife. Our legs refuse to move. Our hands tremble. Our bodies are a thin skin stretched painfully over repressed madness, over an almost irresistible bursting roar. We have neither flesh nor muscles any longer. We dare not look at one another for fear of some miscalculable thing. We shut our teeth. It will end. It will end. Perhaps we will come through. Suddenly, the nearer explosions cease. The shelling continues, but it has lifted and falls behind us. Our trench is free. We seize the hand grenades, pitch them out in front of the dugout and jump after them. The bombardment has stopped and the heavy barrage now follows behind us. The attack has come. No one would believe that in this howling waste, there could still be men. But steel helmets now appear on all sides of the trench, all sides out of the trench, and 50 yards from us, a machine gun is already in position and barking. The wire entanglements are torn to pieces, yet they offer some obstacle. We see the stormtroops coming. Our artillery opens fire. Machine guns rattle, rifles crack. The charge works its way across. Hai and Krop begin with the hand grenades. They throw as fast as they can. Others pass them, the handles with the strings already pulled. Hai throws 75 yards, crop 60. It has been measured. The distance is important. The enemy, as they run, cannot do much before they are within 40 yards. We recognize the smooth, distorted faces, the helmets. They are French. They have already suffered heavily when they reach the remnants of the barbed wire entanglements. A whole line has gone down before our machine guns. Then we have a lot of stoppages and they come nearer. I see one of them, his face upturned, fall into a wire cradle. His body collapses, his hands remain suspended as though he were praying. Then his body drops clean away and only his hands, with the stumps of his arms shot off, now hang in the wire. The moment we are about to retreat, three faces rise up from the ground in front of us. Under one of the helmets, a dark pointed beard and two eyes that are fastened on me. I raise my hand, but I cannot throw into those strange eyes. For one mad moment, the whole slaughter whirls like a circus around me, and these two eyes alone are motionless. Then the head rises up, and a hand, a movement, and my hand grenade flies through the air and into him. We make for the rear, pull wire cradles into the trench, and leave bombs behind us with the strings pulled, which ensures us a fiery retreat. The machine guns are already firing from the next position. We have become wild beasts. We do not fight. We defend ourselves against annihilation. It is not against men that we fling our bombs. What do we know of men in this moment when death is hunting us down? Now, for the first time in 3 days, we can see his face. Now, for the first time in 3 days, we can oppose him. We feel a mad anger. No longer do we lie helpless, waiting in the scaffold. We can destroy and kill to save ourselves and to be revenged. We crash behind every corner, behind every barrier of barbed wire, and hurl heaps of explosives at the feet of the advancing enemy before we run. The blast of the hand grenades impinges powerfully on our arms and legs. Crouching like cats, we run on, overwhelmed by this wave that bears us along, that fills us with ferocity, turns us into thugs, into murderers, into God only knows what devils. This wave that multiplies our strength with fear and madness and greed of life, seeking and fighting for nothing but our deliverance. If your own father came over with them, you would not hesitate to fling a bomb at him. The forward trenches have been abandoned. Are they still trenches? They're blown to pieces, annihilated. There are only broken bits of trenches, holes linked by cracks, nests of craters, that is all. But the enemy's casualties increase. They do not count on so much resistance. It is nearly noon. The sun blazes hot. The sweat stings in our eyes. We wipe it off in our sleeves and often blood with it. At last we reach a trench that is in somewhat better condition. It is manned and ready for the counterattack. It receives us. Our guns open in full blast and cut off the enemy attack. The lines behind us stop. They can advance no farther. The attack is crushed by artillery. We watch. The fire lifts 100 yards and we break forward. Besides me, a lance corporal has his head torn off. He runs a few steps more while blood spouts from his neck like a fountain. It does not come quite to hand-to-hand fighting. They are driven back. We arrive once again at our shattered trench and pass on beyond it. Oh, this turning back again. We all reach the shelter of the reserves and yearn to creep in and disappear, but instead we must turn round and plunge again into the horror. If we are not automata at this moment, we will continue lying there, exhausted and without will. But we are swept forward again, powerless, madly savage and raging. We will kill, for they are still our mortal enemies. Their rifles and bombs are aimed against us, and if we don't destroy them, they will destroy us. The brown earth, the torn, blasted earth, with a greasy shine under the sun's rays. The earth is the background of this restless, gloomy world of automatons. Our grasping is the scratching of a quill. Our lips are dry, our heads are debauched with stupor. Thus we stagger forward, and into our pierced and shattered souls bores the torturing image of the brown earth with the greasy sun and the convulsed and dead soldiers who lie there. It can't be helped, who cry and clutch at our legs as we spring away over them. We have lost all feelings for one another. We can hardly control ourselves when our glance lights on the form of some other man. We are insensible, dead men, who through some trick, some dreadful magic, are still able to run and kill. A young Frenchman lags behind. He is overtaken. He puts up his hands, and in one he still holds his revolver. Does he mean to shoot or to give himself? A blow from a spade cleaves through his face. A second sees it and tries to run farther. A bayonet jabs into his back. He leaps into the air, his arms thrown wide, his mouth wide open, yelling. He staggers. In his back, the bayonet quivers. A third throws away his rifle, cowers down with his hands before his eyes. He is left behind with a few other prisoners to carry off the wounded. Suddenly, in the pursuit, we reach the enemy line. We are so close on the heels of our retreating enemies that we reach it almost at the same time as they. In this way, we suffer a few casualties. A machine gun barks, but is silenced with a bomb. Nevertheless, the couple of seconds that has sufficed to give us five stomach wounds. But the butt of his rifle, Cat smashes to a pulp the face of one of the unwounded machine gunners. We bayonet the others before they have time to get out their bombs. Then thirstily we drink the water they have cooling for the gun. Everywhere wire cutters are snapping. Planks are thrown across the entanglements. We jump through the narrow entrances into the trenches. Heis strikes his spade into the neck of a gigantic Frenchman and throws the first hand grenade. We duck behind a breastwork for a few seconds, and then the straight bit of trench ahead of us is empty. The next throw whizzes obliquely over a corner and clears a passage. As we run past, we toss handfuls down into the dugouts. The earth shudders. It crashes, smokes, and groans. We stumble over slippery lumps of flesh, over yielding bodies. I fall into an open belly on which lies a clean, new officer's cap. The fight ceases. We lose touch with the enemy. We cannot stay here longer, but must retire under cover of our artillery to our own position. No sooner do we know this than we dive into the nearest dugouts and with the utmost haste seize on whatever provisions we can see, especially the tins of corned beef and butter, before we clear out. We get back pretty well. There's no further attack by the enemy. We lie for an hour panting and resting before anyone speaks. We are so completely played out that in spite of our great hunger, we do not think of the provisions. Then gradually we become something like men again. The corned beef over there is famous along the whole front. Occasionally it has been the chief reason for a flying raid on our part, for our nourishment is generally very bad. We have constant hunger. We have bagged five tins altogether. The fellows over there are well looked after. They fare magnificently. As against us, poor starving wretches, with our turnip jam, they can get all the meat they want. Hai has scored a thin loaf of white French bread and stuck it behind his belt like a spade. It is a bit bloody on one corner, but that can be cut off. It's a good thing we have something decent to eat at last. We still have a use for all of our strength. Enough to eat is just as valuable as a good dugout. It can save our lives. That is the reason why we are so greedy for it. Tiaden has captured two water bottles full of cognac. We pass them around.